Welcome viewers. Today in this program, we are going to talk about hypothesis testing. As you are well aware that the whole subject of statistics is divided into two major parts. First one is descriptive statistics and second one is inferential statistics. Hypothesis testing comes under inferential statistics. First, let us know what is inferential statistics. As we know that it is that branch of statistics where a sample is taken, then the sample is investigated, then the results of sample investigation are used for making generalizations about the nature and characteristic of the population. So, in other words, we can say that we are making inferences about the population based on sample investigation. That is why it is called inferential statistics. In this branch, basically we focus on two things. One is estimation and second is hypothesis testing. In this program, we are going to focus on hypothesis testing. Here we are going to talk about what is a hypothesis, particularly what is a null hypothesis and what is an alternative hypothesis. Then we will also discuss what are the characteristics of a hypothesis, then what is the hypothesis testing procedure. We will also be talking towards the end of the program about what are the different types of errors which are committed in hypothesis testing, and finally, we will be discussing the decision making criteria regarding hypothesis testing. So, friends, first of all, let us focus on what is hypothesis. A hypothesis is an assumption underlying the relationship among the variables of the study. In a research, there can be many variables, and then some of the variables may be having interrelationship. So, we can hypothesize about the assumed relationship among these variables. That takes the shape of a hypothesis. As I was telling you that there are two types of hypothesis. One is a null hypothesis and another one is a alternative hypothesis. Now, null hypothesis is, as the name itself suggests, it says that the two variables are not related, or the one variable is not causing any change in the other variable, or the one variable is not dependent on any other variable. The alternate hypothesis is just opposed to the null hypothesis. That is, if the null hypothesis says that there is no significant difference between two variables, let us say x and y, alternate hypothesis will say that there is significant difference between x and y. Here it is very important to mention that the numerical testing of hypothesis invariably requires formulation of null as well as alternate hypothesis. Now, friends, let us focus on what are the different important characteristics of hypothesis. First and foremost, the hypothesis that we are framing should be clear and precise. It should be drawn from the literature that we have reviewed, and that is where it is very interesting that the outcome of exploratory research is in the form of hypothesis that we are able to develop. These hypotheses must be capable of being tested as well. Now, they also state the relationship between the variables of the study. These hypotheses must be very specific, and they should be within the focus of the and scope of the research that we are undertaking. They should be consistent with the known facts. As I have said that if you have reviewed literature, then from there we can generate some hypothesis. It should also be able to explain what it claims to explain, in the sense that it should have empirical reference, meaning thereby that these variables must be quantifiable, and then we can numerically test the hypothesis. So, friends, we have been talking about a hypothesis, a null hypothesis, an alternative hypothesis, and then we have also been discussing some of the characteristics of hypothesis. Now, let us move further and let us discuss about what are the different criteria which are used by researcher for construction of a hypothesis. First and foremost is that a hypothesis must be empirically testable. Whether it is right or wrong is altogether a different issue, because the result of hypothesis testing will reveal that whether the null hypothesis is to be accepted or to be rejected. But then the basic point is that it should be empirically testable. Now, second thing is that, as I have already said, that the statement in the hypothesis should not be contradictory to each other, and also that the hypothesis should be such that it clearly describes the relationship among the variables. And finally, it should subscribe to one issue only, meaning thereby that in one hypothesis, we will take up one issue at a time. For example, if we want to study the effect of any demographic variable, for example, let us say the age of the respondent on their IQ score or EQ score, so then our variables will be very clear that age as the independent variable and either IQ or EQ as the dependent variable. So that is how the null hypothesis as well as alternate hypothesis should be constructed. Friends, let us now go through this diagram flow chart. The first step here is that we have to state the null hypothesis, which is having the notation of H0. 0 is there in the subscript, and then also as well as we have to have an alternate hypothesis which has the notation of HA or H1. So then one hypothesis that we have framed will be H0, and its alternate could be H1 or HA. This kind of notations are there. So first step in hypothesis testing is that we should be able to clearly state both the null as well as alternate hypothesis. Second step here is that the researcher should specify the level of significance. Commonly, three levels of significance are used: 10%, 5%, and 1%. Even more useful or mostly used levels are 5% and 1% level of significance. We will talk more about this when we will be discussing the concept of error. Third is that we have to describe the correct sampling distribution that is used in our study. Next is that fourth step in the hypothesis testing is that we have to select a random sample, and we have to also work out an appropriate value for that particular sample that we have chosen. Then the next step is numerical in nature, that is where we calculate the probability that this sample would result and this sample would actually diverge as widely as it has from expectations if true, meaning thereby that using the mathematical formula, we will calculate the calculated value of the statistics whichever test we are using. Then next is that we compare this calculated value with the tabulated value. The tabulated value would be the standard value of the test for that particular level of significance. Then we compare the calculated value with the tabulated value. If the calculated value is less or equal to the tabulated value, then we will accept the null hypothesis, and otherwise, that is, if the calculated value is greater than the tabulated value, then we will reject the null hypothesis and then we accept the alternate hypothesis. So, in other words, we can say that either we accept or reject, in both the cases, we run the risk of committing one or the other type of error. Now, when we are talking about the hypothesis, then it can be like this, that for example, we have the null hypothesis as mu is equal to mu 0, meaning thereby that the population mean is equal to some hypothesized mean value. Now, the alternate hypothesis could be that mu is not equal to mu 0. So, why you have seen that the null hypothesis was mu is equal to mu 0 and the alternate hypothesis was mu not equal to mu 0. Similarly, we can have two more extensions of this situation where the null hypothesis can be mu less or equal to mu 0, then in that case the alternate hypothesis would be mu greater than mu 0. And third and final case could be like that where the null hypothesis is mu greater than or equal to mu 0, then the alternate hypothesis will be mu less or equal to, less than mu 0. Now, this is where you have understood that this kind of possibilities are there in formation of the null hypothesis as well as the alternate hypothesis. The first case where mu is equal to mu 0 was the null hypothesis and mu not equal to mu 0 was the alternate hypothesis gives rise to the two-tailed test, because the deviation could be in either of the two directions. While the remaining two cases where the alternate hypothesis was in one single direction only, they both were examples of one-tailed test only. Now, when we talk about how graphically we can show that the acceptance region or rejection region and in what case our null hypothesis will be accepted or it will be rejected. So, that is where this graph can help us see this situation. Here in this graph, you can see that acceptance region is there in the middle where the normal curve is peaking, and then this acceptance region is equal to 1 minus alpha, and as long as the statistics value falls in this acceptance region, we will be accepting the null hypothesis, that is H 0. And now you are able to see in both the tails, in the left hand side as well as in the right hand side, this shaded area is there, and in this shaded area you see that the rejection region is there, and this is because of the test being a two-tailed test, and so rejection region lies both on the left side of the curve as well as on the right side of the curve. And we see that the area is equally divided in terms of alpha by 2 on the left hand side and alpha by 2 on the right hand side. Now, this shows us that if our statistic value, that randomly chosen statistic value, falls under any of these two extremes, rejection region, then we will be actually rejecting the null hypothesis. So, graphically we can see from here that how the acceptance region and rejection region are shown in the graph. Now, the question arises in the mind of the researcher as to which test must be used in which particular situation. So, selection of the test depends upon many factors. The first factor is that whether the test involves one sample or two sample or many samples. Similarly, whether two or more samples that are used are either independent or they are related in some manner. And third and final one is that what is the measurement scale, whether it is nominal or ordinal or interval or ratio. So, based on these factors, then we can make a judgment about which test to be used in which particular situation. Friends, here two more important things are there when we try to understand that whether the Z test is to be used or T test is to be used. When we are faced with this question that whether we have to use the Z test or T test, then basically two parameters are required. One is that whether the population standard deviation is known to the researcher or population standard deviation is unknown to the researcher. Similarly, another criteria is that whether the sample size is greater than 30 or less than or equal to 30. So, that is where you will find that in this particular table of 2 by 2 matrix, you will find that out of 4 situations, in three situations, Z test is used. In which situations? Where the population standard deviation is known. So, whether the sample size is more than 30 or less than or equal to 30, Z test will be used. And in the situation where the population standard deviation is unknown, then if the sample size is greater than 30, we will use the Z test. And only in one instance where the population standard deviation is unknown as well as the sample size is less than or equal to 30, we will be using the T test. Similarly, our hypothesis testing can be used for testing the difference between means of two samples, and so that is where then again based on this criteria we can go for either Z test or T test. Now, if we are having more than two samples and if we are trying to identify that what kind of difference that exists among the these three subsets of the population, so that is where we will be using the F test. These all are parametric tests. We can also make use of a non-parametric test called chi-square, and that is where chi-square, generally we use the test of chi-square as a test of independence. So, that is where we can frame the null hypothesis and test is using the chi-square statistics. So, friends, this was brief discussion about what different kinds of tests are there and in which situations these tests are to be used. This flow chart also makes it very clear that first question we ask is that, is the population normal? And if the question, the answer to this question is yes, then we further ask, is the population standard deviation known? Again, if the answer is yes, then our decision is made that we have to use the Z test. And if the population is normal, yes, population standard deviation is unknown, then we will be using the T test. On the other hand, even if the left hand side, if you see, if the population is not normal, but the sample size n is greater or equal to 30, if that is answer to this question is yes, then we will be using the Z test. And if then the sample size is less than 30, then we will be using a non-parametric test. So, this is where this flow diagram also helps us in determination of a particular test. Now, as we have been discussing that the procedure of hypothesis testing is not free from errors. There are two types of errors that may occur. These are called type 1 error and type 2 error. As a researcher, you must have an idea about what is type 1 error and what is type 2 error. Now, basically we go by the null hypothesis H 0, and the type the state of nature can be that the null hypothesis is true, and the second option is that the null hypothesis can be false. And type of decision can be either rejecting null hypothesis or accepting null hypothesis. Now, friends, from this table you can see very clearly that where the null hypothesis is true and if it is rejected, then it will result in type 1 error. That is shown in the first cell of the 2x2 matrix. Now, the second column we move to, where the null hypothesis is false, but we reject it, and the null hypothesis that is rejected, meaning thereby that rejecting a false null hypothesis will lead us to correct decision, and that is where we will not be making any kind of error. Moving down, if we take a decision of accepting null hypothesis, and if the state of nature says the null hypothesis is true, then it will be the correct decision and there will be no error. Finally, when we are accepting a false null hypothesis, then we are committing another type of error, that is called type 2 error, that is beta. So, friends, the probability of type 1 error is called alpha, and the probability of type 2 error is called beta. This probability of type 1 error alpha is actually also called as the level of significance. So, friends, we have been talking about this subject of hypothesis testing, in which we have first talked about that it is a part of the inferential statistics. Then we have also discussed what is a hypothesis, what is a null hypothesis, what is an alternate hypothesis, then what are the different characteristics, what are the criteria in construction of a hypothesis, what are the different steps in testing of hypothesis. We have also talked about that in which situation which statistical test of hypothesis testing should be used, like for example, Z test, T test, F test, chi square and so on. And finally, we have also been talking about the concept of error that may creep into our research because of hypothesis testing. So, friends, this was a brief discussion on hypothesis testing. Thank you for viewing, as this can be very important for you in the quantitative research.